Greetings, everybody, and welcome at long last to the rather anticlimactic finale of Rust and Relaxation. It's been an interesting journey, as it always is, but unfortunately we never really got to finish this build, did we? This appears to be the last leveling up that we're going to be able to do for this playthrough. But we got two-thirds of the way there. I guess we can go home happy. Or I can. I know there's probably going to be completionists in the audience going, "God damn it, no, you can't leave it on this cliffhanger!" I'm sorry, guys. But that's just the way it is. We've got to play the hand we're dealt here. Now, I do want to get to some last questions and comments before we wrap this thing up. So, first of all, I had discussed a few episodes ago that, in reference to Rhea of Thurland, that I was tired of the damsel in distress trope. And a number of people asked me about that in the comments in regards to, well, you know, what problem do you have with Rhea specifically, because she does fit in context and various other points to that effect. And yes, I certainly don't disagree that she does. It's not Rhea herself that I have an issue with. I'm just tired of the trope. And Rhea certainly, in the context of being a cleric and needing escorts and having been raised probably in a very, in fact we know having been raised in a very privileged family and had an educated upbringing, very well to do, etc., etc. Yes, I get that in the context of her role in the story, being a damsel in distress does totally fit. That's certainly true. But the issue is just that I get so sick of seeing damsels in distress in video games. They're such a cliche that even in a game I love so much as the Souls series, regardless of which entry in the Souls series it is, to be honest, the whole damsel in distress thing just smacks of Princess Peach, and I can't help but roll my eyes every time I see it. And people brought up the very good point, with which I have to agree, that you really spend a hell of a lot more time rescuing Siegmire than you do Rhea, or really pretty much anybody else in this game. And so, in that regard, circumstantially, Siegmire is a bit more of a damsel in distress, really, than Rhea. And yeah, guys, I just wanted to illustrate what happens if you walk off this epic staircase through the fog or through some alternate dimension to the Kiln of the First Flame. It isn't really clear quite what this transitional area is, but it's interesting that we see here the ghosts of the Black Knights who were incinerated when Gwyn relit the First Flame. And the lore, of course, of the Silver Knights in that case is that they were burned black when they fought the Chaos Demons, but that just turned their armor black and gave them a great deal of resistance to fire, which presumably was why Gwyn decided to bring them along with him when he came here to the Kiln of the First Flame to link the fire. Their fire defense clearly did not help them very much. They ate shit anyway. And now, unfortunately, they wander Lordran as ghosts, and that is why we periodically encounter them in places throughout Lordran. The Kiln of the First Flame is an interesting area as well, for a number of reasons. First of all, the ground that we're walking on here is actually ash, and that large building over there would appear to be a temple, but in actual fact, architecturally, it incorporates aspects of a kiln as well. And for those of you who don't know what a kiln is, I can't imagine too many people not knowing what a kiln is. But a kiln is essentially a type of oven, usually made out of clay, but sometimes brick, in which typically pottery was fired, but in some cases, clay and brick ovens were used for cooking as well. But the term kiln specifically has a connotation of being used for firing things at very, very high temperatures. And therefore, it is quite fitting that the first flame is lit in a kiln. The implication here is that all of the ash on the ground was left when the first flame was either originally lit or when Gwyn relit it. And the Black Knights, basically overrunning this area, are ghosts of those who accompanied Lord Gwyn when he came here to link the fire. kind of a sad end for these guys, but interesting nonetheless. And we're going to go I guess I really can't say explore, because this area is quite linear and straightforward. There's not an awful lot of exploration to be done here. But paying attention to the architecture and the environment probably is a good idea for those particularly interested in the sorts of lore that you gather by context. And somebody in a previous episode pointed out in the comments that looking down below us, there is... I can't remember the exact comment or what the words were, but there was some point somebody made in which he or she highlighted an aspect of the terrain way down below that somehow corroborates or helps to confirm that this is indeed a kiln. I think it was someone who, it might have been Gibb that went down there in the debug menu with noclip and did some exploration and found something. I don't remember what it was, though. If anyone does remember, I'd appreciate it if you could point it out in the comments. But if we rescued Solaire, if he has not died before now, we can summon him for the final battle with Lord Gwyn. I do not like to summon Solaire for this battle when I plan on handling it the way that I'm going to handle it. Also, I want to illustrate, I'm not sure if this is due just to bad pathing or to the environment, but yeah, later, idiot. Have a nice trip. See you in the fall. Yeah. I can look really smooth when I trick the Great Axe Black Knight into doing that, because it's easy. But I always forget the positioning for the Halberd Black Knight. And I was not so smooth, unfortunately, in his case. But I'm going to get to one more question that a lot of people have been asking me lately, which is about politics. A lot of people have been asking me, would I be interested in or willing to discuss politics? And would I share my political opinions in the comments? And the short answer is no. You guys have to understand, first of all, I have no particular love for politics. I deal with it every day at work during my day job, and I view it as a necessary evil over the course of my day job, and it isn't really an aspect of my work that I particularly enjoy, much though I do love my work in general. But in connection with that, when I come home from work and I sit down to record a video, I really don't want to deal with or think about politics. I just want to play some video games and relax and unwind, you know? And I guess that's really the most I can say. Politics is something that I really do not relish discussing. And it's not that I don't enjoy a good scholarly discussion, I do. But with politics in particular, people are so sensitive about opinions besides their own that I fear, even with a channel like mine, where the overall inclination of people is to just be respectful and civil, there are always going to be those few people who show up and just say, in the middle of a nice scholarly discussion, that just show up and say, Barack Obama's a poo-poo face, and then someone else shows up and says, I heart fascism. And invariably somebody brings up Hitler, and it all just goes to hell from there. I really have no particular desire to relive that day after day, or even once in a while. So I have no problem if you guys discuss politics in the comments. That's totally fine with me, as long as you're civil and respectful about it. But I hope you'll forgive me if I opt not to join in. Oh, that was the final boss, by the way. In any case, moving on. No, we do. Gwyn deserves a little bit better than just that. But I wanted to illustrate for people who've only played Dark Souls 2, and or even people who played Dark Souls 1, and don't understand the complaints that some individuals have about Gwyn being an insufficient final boss. I'm not saying I fully share those complaints, but that was basically why. I think a lot of people come into this fight expecting something really epic and huge and just enormous. But that's not the point of the fight with Lord Gwyn here. The point is to show that, as Cath will tell us if, or would have told us if we'd been able to hear his dialogue, Lord Gwyn is faded. He's basically not relevant anymore. He used up the last of his power to link the fire, which we now have the choice to do, and this is a gripe I have with the ending of Dark Souls 2, is that it doesn't really give you the sense that you have any power of choice. Here, we can choose to either link the fire, use ourselves as kindling, die. If we link the fire, we'll get burned. But the Age of Fire will continue, which may or may not be a good thing for reasons that we really don't have time to discuss now, unfortunately. Or we can just say, fuck it, and turn our back on the first flame and walk out. Let the fire die, usher in the Age of Dark, and say, you know what? The time for the gods is done. The world now belongs to humans.
My lord, bless thy safe return. Let Karth and Frampt serve your highness. We are here to serve your highness.
And nobody lived happily ever after, except me and my new serpent friends, and the humans. But yeah, the gods all died. Screw them. And there it is, my friends. That is Dark Souls 1. And unfortunately, that ending makes a lot more sense if you hear Darkstalker Cath's dialogue. We have not had an opportunity to hear Darkstalker Cath's dialogue. So you guys will just have to go back and watch somebody else's playthrough of Dark Souls 1, or watch one of my previous playthroughs of Dark Souls 1, in which they actually do get to hear Cath's dialogue. But basically he just talks about how the player's ancestor was the progenitor of the human race and held the original Dark Soul. And the deal with the Dark Soul is that it was... When Manus died, or, well, even before Manus died, because he dies at the player's hands, but at some point after Manus claimed the Dark Soul, it was split apart into countless different fragments. And each of those fragments wound up inside every last human. And those are the humanity that every human has. So I guess, in retrospect, it was probably when Manus gave birth to the human race, or however that happened, because Manus is male, so use your imaginations, and I'm not going to think too hard about that, but however it actually took place, the Dark Soul appears to have divided itself between all of the humans who were born from Manus, and that is why every human has humanity, and that is why humanity looks a little bit like a Dark Soul. So... hopefully that will answer some questions for those of you who are not familiar with the lore of Dark Souls 1. And that's really all I have to say here. I'd like to at least let everybody read the voice cast, because these guys are, for the most part, people you've probably never heard of. And that's because they all essentially just work for Frog Nation, which is a tiny little... How do I describe them? They're essentially a localization company, but they provide voice talent as well. They're based in the UK somewhere, I don't remember exactly where. But that is why most of their names are English names. And good old Patches, Will Vanderpoort. One of the most iconic voice actors of the Souls series, and Motoi Sakuraba, the composer, for those of you who aren't familiar with his work, he's responsible for the scores of such classics as Valkyrie Profile and Star Ocean. Incredibly talented guy. Nice guy, too. Good sense of humor. Look him up on YouTube if you're interested in some of his other work. He's done some really good stuff. An interesting variety he does. He seems to like synthesized music a lot. And the Star Ocean soundtracks in particular utilize a lot of synthesized music. But the Valkyrie Profile soundtracks, particularly the arranged albums of those soundtracks, use a lot more instrumental sounding, granted still synthesized, but synthesized instruments rather than just, you know, that he's playing a keyboard. So, yeah, check him out. Really great composer. He's up there with Uematsu and Kondo and Shimomura and all the all-time greats. He's definitely in that league. So, yeah, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank everybody once again for joining me for Rust and Relaxation. I'm sure there's still more rust yet to be shaken, but this has been a good start, and I appreciate everybody continuing to correct me in the comments when I misremembered something and got something wrong. In any case, I'll just wrap it up here, because the credits are pretty much over. And, there's not an awful lot for me to say. So, yeah, thank you all once again for joining me, and I don't know if I'm going to... I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to do in the future. I still have to finish Richter's build, so maybe he would be willing to help me out with Dark Souls in depth when I get around to it. It probably will be a while, guys. Frankly, I want to do something else. I want to explore some new territory, and... I don't know, play some games I haven't played yet, something new. But yeah, we're going to wrap it up here. Thank you for joining me for Rust and Relaxation. What an adventure this has been. I look forward to seeing you guys for whatever I choose to do from here on out. Take care, everybody.